Steve James, please give him a big hand.
Thank you.
We are very proud that he compiled his top 10 of favorite documentaries. And of course, we also show a kind of retrospect of his work here. Not everything, but some of the films. And this morning, this talk show will be hosted by the one and only Peter Wintonik. Please give him a hand as well.
Thank you.
And enjoy, have a good time. And don't hesitate to ask questions, because that's why Steve is here. Thank you.
Thank you, Ali. It's remarkable that like 4 hours ago, this was a discotheque and people were dancing. Maybe some of you still left over from the dancing. But I'd really like to thank our technical crew really at the beginning, because they do this miraculous transformation in about an hour and get everything wired up and seats set up. So I say that as people are looking at the screen as things are flickering. But it is a great pleasure to introduce the series. We're having four of these things. We used to call them master classes, but the masters got tired of being called masters, I think. So we've changed this to meet the makers, and we're trying to emphasize really, as these are kind of open to the public events, and we're recording them, and they're streaming out live on the IDFA TV, and will be recorded for posterity, and we'll have some use for others that are not in the room. So these Meet the Makers really kind of chance to meet the filmmakers involved. All of the Brazilians will be all on the stage, all 25 of them on Monday at the same time. And a lot of musicians performing on Tuesday at the same time. And we'll be talking about popular documentary on Wednesday here. But it's really a pleasure to introduce Steve, a kind of friend, a film friend as well. We've enjoyed the stages in Beijing a couple of years ago, where he did a kind of 6-hour masterclass for a lot of emerging Chinese filmmakers, and this year in Adelaide in Australia at the Australian International Documentary Conference, we did a kind of shared a panel or a discussion really about our own histories and biographies. And it was there or at Hot Docs this year that Steve started contemplating his top 10. We invite an illustrious filmmaker every year. I think Herzog, Kim Longinato, others over the last 20 years or so of IDFA, really to look back and reflect upon what they think or define as influential films or their personal canon of films. And Steve has been quite industrious. I really encourage you to read in the big IDFA catalog his essay about the motivations for some of his choices. And it's a kind of a beautiful way to reflect for the people who are watching on the history of important films in the documentary history, but also I guess for you as the curator of the top 10, a kind of chance to reflect on those films which have been influential to the career of Steve James. Maybe I'll just briefly mention those films, and then just for the record, and then we'll really get really into it with Steve considering some of those top 10, and also this kind of construction of an idea behind this whole Meet the Makers is really to pair choices from his top 10 to the seven films or parts of those seven films that are in his retrospective here, to figure out what really are the connections between those and what has he learned as a filmmaker. So in his top 10, he chose Michael Apted's 28 Up, Chris Smith's American Movie, the great unknown film really from Barbara Kopple, Fallen Champ, about Mike Tyson, Golub, a film he worked on with his partner Gordon Quinn.
I didn't work on it.
Oh, I thought you did.
No.
It was a contemporary film.
It was there when I first got there.
The company that you do a lot of work with.
Yeah.
Grey Gardens, the Maisel's film, Jolly May, the great Chris Marker film. Our Trip to Africa, kind of unseen film too, was a great choice. The Staircase, which is this 8-hour-long series we played here a few years ago. I watched it all in one day, I remember, and a series that Jean-Xavier Lestrade from France made, and The Times of Harvey Milk, and Tongues Untied. So we've chosen five of those films to really talk about today, pairing up with five of the films we're playing in Steve's retrospective, Hoop Dreams and the new At the Death House Door, The Interrupters, The New Americans, No Crossover, Real Paradise, and Stevie. So that's just really for the record. So I really encourage you to see all of those 17 films. Are you doing Q&As for all of those, or introducing them?
Introducing the top 10s and doing Q&As for my films. So
I don't want to really get into too much biography, so I'll just say that you're a fantastic guy as a person. You were born in Virginia. This is the quick WikiLeaks, Wikipedia version. You went to school, university.
I hope it's not WikiLeaks. That would
WikiLeaks. The truth is out. You went to the University of Southern Illinois. I consider you a kind of Chicago filmmaker. So you were Chicago, the city that has informed a lot of your films, and where the present president of your country comes from too, which it may be an irony or it may be a natural connection. So let's just get into it, Steve. We want to really talk about pairs of films, and maybe you can just give us a kind of overall general idea when we gave you the task to choose those 10 films.
Yeah, it's your idea, Peter, to do this, which was to take films that I had selected and films of mine and look for connections. I mean, in the essay that I wrote for the catalog, I make some of these connections. Because most of the films I selected were films that influenced me when I was really starting to want to make films, in particular want to make documentaries. So it's not my all-time favorite 10 favorite films. I couldn't possibly come up with that list, but it was a way to try to come up with 10 films that really had an impact on me. And so what we've done is we've selected some of these films from the top 10 and from my films, and as Peter said, kind of paired together clips from each one that hopefully kind of illuminate certain aspects of making documentaries, at least for me. And the first one up is, we're going to look at a clip from American Movie, the Chris Smith film, which is one of the later films in the 10 that I selected. I was already had made Hoop Dreams at the point in time I saw Chris's film, and Chris became a friend, and he sent me a rough cut of the, or actually a pretty fine cut of the film at one point, and I watched it late one night at home with the idea that I was going to give him some notes, and it was the funniest documentary I'd ever seen, and it might still be the funniest documentary I've ever seen, and yet it is a film that has tremendous poignancy too. I think this is where your quote should come.
Well, what is that quote?
You know which one I'm talking about?
No.
Oh, well, when we were at lunch yesterday, we were talking about how...
We weren't even drinking at lunch.
We were talking about how there just aren't enough funny documentaries.
Oh, and this is right. Yeah, this is my theory anyway, really, about the human condition as we're supposed to be capturing some kind of reality. For me, the human condition really includes a lot of humor. Half of our lives, at least, every day are in some kind of, at least, not joyful state, but at least pleasant state, and that there's a lot of jokes exchanged between people. But about 3%, we'll say, of the 330 films playing at IDFA, I would say five of them are, you know, have some kind of humor, including this one you've chosen, Chris Smith. I mean, he made the film about the Yes Men. They're funny people,
yeah,
from time to time. But it's pretty, well, I was posed to Ali this question, like, what's funny here?
Yeah. So yeah, you know, he was saying, well, the quote was, half of the human condition is about humor, but 95% of documentary filmmaking is about the other half, or something like that.
Yeah.
So anyway, in my own work, even though my work is not characterized as comedies, I always feel like I'm always looking for humor in these stories. Particularly, I think it's important in more serious films, because people are funny, and humor is a way people cope with their lives. But, you know, the scene I'm going to show you from American Movie is actually just a unmitigatedly hilarious scene, in my view. And for those of you who haven't seen the movie, it's about a guy from Wisconsin. How many people have seen it? Okay. So it's about a struggling filmmaker from Milwaukee, Wisconsin, who Chris discovered, who was trying to get he had this grand vision of making his sort of magnum opus film called Northwestern. But in order to fund that, he needed to finish this short horror film which he called Coven, even though it's really pronounced Coven. But that's the way he pronounced it, so that's what it's called. And it's a film that you know, is, like I said, it's quite hilarious, but it also is this really great sort of indelible portrait of this fledgling American dream of this filmmaker who comes from a working class family, is struggling financially, has kids. And so this scene that you're going to see is he's shooting on Coven, and he's shooting one of the more important scenes in the movie. And then what we're going to follow it with is a scene from a film I did some years after that called Real Paradise, about a family that went to Fiji. This guy, John Pearson, who used to be quite a well-known independent film guru, frankly, he took his family to Fiji to run the world's most remote movie theater. And John is one of these guys who's a very provocative guy. He loves to provoke reactions. He was behind Michael Moore's first film. He was behind Thin Blue Line. He was behind Spike Lee's first film. So he's a very interesting guy, and his family's quite interesting. And so when he was in Fiji showing these movies, some of the movies he showed were meant to provoke people, including the Catholic Church. And so we'll show a sequence from that film as well, where he decided to show Jackass. So we'll show both these sequences back to back, and then maybe just talk a little bit and then move on to the next clip.
Sorry, I tried to put your head in this. This is gonna be like, take some shit. Go. Next. You sick motherfucker! You motherfucking crazy man! Come out here, man! Nerves twitching, please. Fingers. Just the fingers. Just the fingers, man. No, just heartbeat. Did you?
Jackass? What do people not like about it?
It has no story. It's a treadmill where they keep doing one stupider stunt after another.
That's awesome. That's the best. I'm happy there's no storyline. If they add a storyline, then it would suck.
That's so true.
I'm standing up there tonight, Wyatt, and crediting / blaming you and Georgia for showing this film.
Fine. And that's all you say tonight.
Sister Rosemary walked by today and she goes, what are you showing tonight? I'm like, don't come. I said, this is not for you. Don't come.
Tell her this.
She goes, yeah, I only came once. I said, well, did you come see enough? And she said, in Main Manhattan this year. So maybe it was this year. She goes, and that was a good one. That was a good one. I'm like, yeah, that was a good one.
Why am I evaluating our success or lack thereof?
With Sister Rosemary.
By what the fuck Sister Rosemary came to see? Mm. As I go back to America, I will never have any contact with any Catholic priest, any sister, brother, for the rest of my life.
Well, I was thinking of the Jackass and this idea of pranking and punking, we would say. I was with the opening film, The Ambassador. I don't know.
I didn't see it.
Matt's, anyway, playing the kind of role playing and punking the Liberian government, the Central African. It's a kind of trend that can actually be used in a sophisticated way. But here we have Chris Smith and the Jackass film as projected in Fiji by John and Janet Pearson into the filmgoers in Fiji. Did you ever have to kind of resort to these kinds of techniques as you were financing films and making films in your early days?
No, I didn't have to do that. It probably would have been a good idea. It might have been a way to fund it. I think the thing about Chris's film is that as you watch this film, you see that this guy Mark, who's the guy that was, you know, pushing the guy's head into the, he's an actor in his own film. You know, you really get this sense when you first see this film. In the first part of it, you're not quite sure what to make of him, and you're not quite sure what to make of the filmmaker's attitude towards him. Near the beginning, you think because he's so funny and because he is so, in some ways, seems kind of clueless as to how he comes across. I think the film makes some people uncomfortable because they think, "Oh, is the filmmaker holding Mark up for, you know, our amusement?" And I think that what was really interesting is as the film progresses, I think most people come to realize that this is a very tender portrait and a very sympathetic portrait of someone who is like this. And I think that's one of the lines that make it hard for documentary filmmakers when it comes to people who are funny like Mark and yet whose lives have a good bit of tragic dimensions as well, is mm-hmm. sort of how do you preserve that sense of who they are as very funny people that if you knew in real life you would be quite amused by, but also balance it with an understanding of the deeper self of who they are. And with John Pearson and his family in Real Paradise, I went over there thinking it was going to be a sort of my comedy documentary because the whole premise was pretty hilarious. And I've shown you a section that, you know, where they showed one of the more provocative films. But when I got there, I filmed the last month of their stay in Fiji. A lot of things happened to the family. John contracted dengue fever. Their house was broken into, and he blamed the drunk landlord. Their daughter ran off for a week, and they didn't know where she was. All this happened in the last month while we were there filming. And so what I set out to do, it still is a pretty funny movie in a lot of ways, for sure, but it ended up being a more serious film than I imagined, which was, I think, a good thing. You know, so I ended up trying to sort of capture both aspects of their lives.
It's a bit different than a lot of your films, which you're among a very rare breed, we'll say, what we call longitudinal filmmaker. You're embedded, I know, with the Hoop Dreams, for 4 years, really, in the lives of those two basketball players, and another few years editing. I think when we first met you, your co-producers, I think in 1992, they were at the American Film Market trying to raise final money with a little 10-minute trailer of what became a long film, actually, along in process. But this, John Pearson and Janet Pearson, you had a relationship with them. You knew them before you arrived on the island, but it was only a month of shooting.
Yeah, which I thought was great, you know, because I've done, you know, not just Hoop Dreams, but the New Americans and Stevie were all films that took 6 to 7 years to make and were involved years of shooting. And so the idea of going off and shooting a film in a month was very appealing to me. Mm-hmm. We still shot quite a bit in a month. The crew felt like I was a total slave driver, but
you chose the right month to be there. Too.
We chose a good month to be there, yes. But it was a great experience, and it was it's like I'm still looking to do. I would love to do another comedic documentary, something that has more humor, because as I said before, I feel like in all the films I've done, even a film like Stevie, which is a pretty dark film, there are moments of humor and levity in them, which I think are essential, but it's also because he could be funny. I mean, there are times when he makes you laugh.
Yes.
So
let's
move on to the next one.
Yeah, we'll move on to the next. Just at the final note there, I think Janet Pearson, who's in that film, is here at IDFA. She's now running programming for the South by Southwest Film Festival.
Right, yeah, John's wife, Janet. Good person to know if you have a film, or meet. So the next selections are from the film Mike Tyson that Barbara Kopple did, Fallen Champ. And I picked this film for the series because many of us are familiar with her Academy Award-winning films, Harlan County, USA, and American Dream. And she's, of course, made a ton of great films. But this was a film that I feel like is completely underrated of hers. And it was done, I saw it when we were in post-production mostly on Hoop Dreams. And it was shown on NBC in prime time as a movie of the week, which was an unprecedented thing at the time, and I don't think it's ever happened since then, to have a documentary shown in that context. And I just was really struck at what a beautifully complicated portrait she had created about Mike Tyson at the time in which the film came out after he had been arrested and charged, if not sentenced, I can't remember, for a rape of a young woman. And so Tyson, who had become the world heavyweight champion and very celebrated, had now fallen, hence the title Fallen Champ. And so this is an incredible portrait. And what was interesting about it is that Barbara, it's mainly a film that takes place between, she did interviews and she had archival footage because she's tracing his rise and fall, and it was a film made after that. So she tried to get permission from Mike Tyson to participate in the film and be interviewed, and he refused to participate. He was willing to participate, according to his handlers, if they could control editorially the film, and Barbara said, no, can't do that. So he appears in the film, as you'll see in this clip, and she found a treasure trove of material but he was not a participant in the film. But yet she manages to make pull off a very rich and complicated portrait of him. I was thinking of her film when I made this film called No Crossover, The Trial of Allen Iverson, about the American basketball player Allen Iverson, who is also a similarly complicated figure. He wasn't arrested for a rape, but the film I made is about when Allen Iverson was in high school. He's from my hometown, and he was involved in a racial bowling alley brawl that totally divided the community and really sort of established his public persona in a way that has been maintained to this day, even though he's like 36 years old now and at the end of his career. The film itself I made has personal aspects to it. I appear in the film in a few places because I go back on this sort of quest to understand what happened, and in the course of that I tell you a little bit about my experiences with race, and I interview my mom. But I'm not going to show you that clip. I'm going to show you two clips, one that I think sort of starts to get at who Mike Tyson was and the complications that would lead to someone like him being charged with and, you know, committing a rape. And then a sequence from my film where I try to get you to understand something about the complicated way in which Allen Iverson was viewed in my hometown as both this basketball hero, but also someone that had a darker undercurrent to him. So we'll look at those two sequences.
Always, no matter who he was with, he would try to knock out anybody, no matter who it was.
That's just to say, he said, don't knock everybody out because you wouldn't have nobody to spar with.
I think that in a way, Mike Tyson is an American pit bull, and that he was trained and that he was bred, you know, to be a killer in the ring. So he's living with this crazy father figure who's totally paranoid about all the other forces in boxing and the steel fighters right now, who think that women make you weak and vulnerable.
Who else? That's all they think about. There's nothing wrong with thinking about girls, but they think about it all the time. Everything they do. Not that me. Guy there lately. No. You. Man, they had a common sense that wouldn't get into trouble.
Complex. Like the other day, right? I was saying, yeah.
Who's got your complex?
You. The other day I was like this. I said, yeah, I'm going to talk to this girl. Then I was saying, nah, I better not do that because doesn't like a fool.
If you do it because I said it, you're a fool. You got to do it because what I said was right. That's what you got to do it for. Not because I said it. All I do is remind you. You got to do it because you know it's right to do it. It's going to benefit you in the long run.
Mike Tyson was maybe 14 or 15, and they had the school dances, and he was shy. So he didn't know what to do to get the girls to even pay attention to him. And so he came to me one day, and he said, now I know what to do. I figured out what to do. I figured out how to make it work. And I said, what do you mean? He says, well, in the dance, he said, I'm always afraid they're going to say no if I ask them to dance. He said, now I know what to do. He said, you run up, and you grab their hand, and you take them out on the floor quick before they have a chance to say no. He said, and then they won't say no because they're too embarrassed, so they'll wait till the dance is over.
I was told by a very personal friend of mine that after they won the state football championship, he didn't come to school for 12 days. When told that we needed a sick slip, he had other words to say about it, and he ended up playing basketball 2 weeks later.
The coaches let him do this. They let him get by with things that he shouldn't have gotten by with.
Iverson missed as many as 69 days of school his junior year, but this may have been due to more than just his lack of interest.
He was such a responsible young man at such a young age because when his mother didn't come home at some evenings, and all night, and Alan would get his older sister off to school, and he would stay with the baby to make sure the baby was going to be okay instead of getting to school.
Outside the home, Coach Kozlowski worried that some of Iverson's associates were involved in drugs, putting the young star's future at risk.
I asked Alan, you were at a drug house, and Coach, do you think I'd do drugs? I said, I didn't say that. I said, well, do you want to help your mother? Yeah, well, how are you going to do that? I'm going to go to the NFL, I'm going to go to the NBA. I said, you get caught at the drug house. I said, the dream ends. You can't help yourself, and you can't help her.
What do you think would have happened to Alan if it hadn't been for you in those early years?
He'd been in the rackets with all the rest of them. Whatever they're doing now, whatever's popular, that's what he'd been doing. Gee, he's just like that. He'd been in, on the street like he's walking there, or he'd been down in some dirt.
Alan didn't have a halo, as we said. Everyone knew it. I think a lot of them thought, here's a thug from the streets. He's been getting away with stuff for a long time. It's time that he pays.
Yep, that Tyson film is just unknown to me. It was great that you chose it so I could discover here.
It's not easy to pick a film that's unknown to you.
No, and I'm making a film about boxing in China, actually. I'm just finishing one with Yung Chang. And we met Tyson this year because Tyson's now being paid lots of money just to make appearances in China. He's still right. Kind of world famous, despite his very checkered life and the desperate life. When you were growing up in Hamptons in Virginia on the East Coast there of America, and you were also a basketball star of some note in high school.
You were tall star. Enough. I wasn't star.
You were not like Iverson became the most valuable player twice, I think, in the National Basketball League of America. But these two films really are also about race, and this is a kind of taboo subject for most filmmakers I know in America. It's interesting to look at all of your work, I think, as a kind of examination of social issues and race, especially in class. And are you sort of conscious of this, or it's because of where you grew up and then living in Chicago?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, in the Iverson film, as you know, there's a part there where I talk about growing up and playing on the basketball team in my high school, which was quite racially divided. It wasn't there wasn't a lot of animosity, or there wasn't a lot of, let's say, open hostility. But it was like living in two separate schools, going to two separate schools. So, like, I tell this story in the Iverson film of when we would have pep rallies for the basketball team or the football team. I played basketball only. When the students would come down to sit in the gym for the pep rally, all the black students would sit on this side, and all the white students would sit on this side of the gym. And when they would introduce a white player, the white side would cheer. And when they'd introduce a black player, the black side would cheer. And it became this informal competition to see who could cheer the loudest. And it was, I remember as a player then thinking it was kind of funny, not really thinking like, this is really horrible, isn't it? But it just seemed more funny than anything, like this really weird competition. But I think that the fact that I played basketball and had many African-American teammates exposed me early on to a different part of my community than I grew up in, than where I lived. And it wasn't a deep connection, which I think was part of what came to me when I decided to eventually make Hoop Dreams, is that part of what was really underlying the desire to make that film was realizing that I had spent many years playing basketball and having African-American teammates, but not ever going, and I talk about this a little bit in the Iverson film, but not as it relates to Hoop Dreams, but never really having a genuine friendship. We were teammates. I was never in their home. They were never in my home. And so in some ways, Hoop Dreams was a way to try to understand something that I had grown up around all my life and never really investigated and understood. And I think that fascination with race came from there, and issues of race that, like you say, have been in a number of the films that I've done.
So we move to the next.
Sure. Let's keep it moving. The next one is, how many people have seen Grey Gardens? Okay, well, we're doing pretty good. Grey Gardens, one of the Maisels Brothers films, is a highly unusual film.
That's Al Maisel's phoning right in there.
Yeah.
the director.
It's an unusual film, I think, for them even, although their work is quite varied, this is a film that was about a mother and a daughter who were living in a dilapidated, mansion in tremendous disrepair together and had been living together for quite some time. And they were they had once been part of a high society. They were related to Jackie Kennedy, you know, Onassis, who became Onassis. And they had once, you know, lived in a very different sort of, and run in a very different circle, and now found themselves basically living this very isolated existence. And the relationship between this mother and daughter is informed by, you know, some very long, complicated history. And this film, which is a very hard film to watch in a lot of ways. I mean, it's the kind of film you wonder could even be made now, frankly, that anyone would finance. But it's a very sort of deep and complicated portrait of these two women who are living in their past in many respects. And what's interesting about it is that it clearly the daughter seems to be in love with David Maisels. I mean, she keeps interacting with him, she wants to impress him. And so the relationship between filmmaker and subject is really interesting in this film. And this is a film, because these are such desperate characters, if you will, it made a lot of people watching this film very uncomfortable. And this is a film that many people thought was exploitative. It was a film that aroused quite a bit of debate about this whole question of, you know, when you're holding people's lives up on display that are tragic in some ways, and that they seem clueless in some ways to the way they come across, is that something we should do as documentary filmmakers? And so, for me, it's a really interesting film for those reasons, as well as being this sort of incredible portrait of these two women. And for me, the connection for this film, for me, is a film I made called Stevie, which is playing here. It hasn't played yet, so you can catch it while you're here. I made a film about a kid that I was once a big brother to, and I reconnected with him 10 years later when he was 24. I was an advocate big brother, this program we have in the States. And I set out to just do a portrait of him, but in the course of doing that portrait, he was charged with sexually molesting his 8-year-old cousin. And so the film evolved to be a film not just about who Stevie was when I was his big brother, and how did he come to this place in his life where he committed this crime. And so this is a film that, when this film came out, it certainly wasn't nearly as popular as Hoop Dreams. But it did cause some division between people. There were people that felt like this film was exploitative of Stevie. And that I was guilty of exploiting him. And I'm in the film, but again, I'm not going to show you a sequence that I'm in. I wonder why I did that. I don't come off as the most positive person in this film, but I've chosen a sequence that I think is a nice pairing with the Grey Gardens, which is, this is later in the movie with Stevie. He's awaiting trial. He's claiming that he's innocent, even though he gave a confession to the police, a written confession. He changed his mind and decided to plead innocent. And then, so this is a scene where he and his girlfriend / fiance, Tanya, who's this incredible person, they come up to Chicago for a visit, which is where we live, my wife and I and our family. But they're going to stay with a friend of Tanya's named Patricia. And Patricia is suffering from cerebral palsy, and she's bedridden. And so I'm not showing you the whole scene because of it's a long scene, but I'm showing you, picking it up partway into the scene, where Tanya and Patricia begin to talk about Stevie's crime.
My father believed in running the children's lives. You know, he wanted me to get my master's degree, be a junior partner in his law firm.
Take the ice cream.
He was 165 Broadway. On the ninth floor, my knees would start to shake.
Coming down.
I was on the ninth floor in Mr. Beale's office, My knees were rotten. My mouth was dry.
You're scared of your father.
And I'd go in and he'd come forward out of his office with his watch in his hand, and then he'd look at the clock on the wall and he'd say, "You're 5 minutes late," he'd say.
Oh. No, he had a very close.
And then he'd sit down and he'd look at me and he'd say, "Take it off! Take that hat off! Take that lipstick off! Take that nail polish off! Oh, how dare you wear those high heels?"
She's acting all over the place.
Don't you want some of this?
Butter pecan.
He said the only thing to be was a professional woman. He did say that. Sydney Moore.
Well, I wouldn't say it's the only thing.
He didn't want me to get married.
I don't think people should get married. I don't believe in it at all.
If you can't get a man to propose to, you might as well be dead.
Well, I don't think it's important.
He's disgusting.
And Mary had the most wonderful life.
Absolutely disgusting.
Lived to be 94 years of age.
What are they proving? They have to go around with dogs or other women or something?
But dogs are lovely.
I was terrible.
I'll take a dog any day.
Oh, God. This is deep for me. I honestly don't want to talk against Steve, but you know what I've been through. I have went to hospitals with busted heads. I literally thought I was going to die. It took me 8 years to put my stepfather behind bars.
Yes.
Do you know what it feels like to be sexually abused?
No.
It's something that I have to deal with for the rest of my life. The rest of my life. Even though he's in prison, I still have nightmares. He doesn't know how much pain he caused me. It took me years to trust a man again.
Yeah, you do, we'll just speak as a film critic for a minute, just connect a lot of your work together, but this is the idea of making the viewer uncomfortable. It's also kind of the title of your essay that you wrote for us, but maybe it was a lesson you also received from working with the Karkatepkin crowd in Chicago. But it is, I was thinking that we have this, the idea of the pantheon of saints, the saints of documentary. We call you Saint. You could be Thomas, the doubting Thomas, but somehow you're in this ambiguous space between you're not the black and white, we'll say. You're not the Michael Moore who thinks he's black and white, but you're in this gray space. You're also always acknowledging yourself, in a way, or the role of filmmaking, as the Maisel brothers, David with the sound boom and Al with the camera, were in Grey Gardens. There's this kind of admission, tentative, I see you as kind of Saint, well, Saint Stephen, but I don't know what Saint, I'm not a Catholic, so I wouldn't know what, but you're.
I'm not either.
I mean, you're not either, so, but it seems like there's this doubt, not in a negative, pejorative way, but this kind of the doubting camera or the exploratory camera that is really looking how to allow us along with you to be in this kind of comfortable, uncomfortable space. I think Stevie is a fantastic film. I'm glad you brought it back. We had it here several years ago, I think, too. But it's, I really would, if you can afford the time to see one of your films, I would really recommend that of the seven that are here.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I think that the stories that I am attracted to are ones that where they're, where there's a lot of room to look at things in a different way, in different ways. And yeah, I think that people are complicated, and I think if you spend enough time with them And you see that more and more. You know, if you come in and take a snapshot, if you film for a few weeks, let's say, or sometime, you know, maybe even longer, you get one kind of view of someone. If you're able to spend months and even years with them, you get a different idea of who they are. And I think with Stevie, what was interesting is there was a film that came out at the same time that was more popular film about sex abuse called Capturing the Friedmans. And both Stevie and Capturing the Friedmans premiered at, well, Stevie premiered here, but both of them played at Sundance and were on the festival circuit and out theatrically at the same time. And Capturing the Friedmans was a much more popular film. And I dare say more of you have seen that film than seen Stevie. But in Capturing the Friedmans, the film is more of a Rashomon about who's at fault. And in Stevie, this is a film where you know he's guilty of this crime, and the goal of the film is to try to get you to understand how someone commits this crime, not point the finger at who did the crime. I always felt like with this film, and in a differing way with Hoop Dreams, is I really want the viewer to wrestle with how they feel about Stevie. On the one hand, to condemn the actions. On the other hand, to try and understand how someone comes to be that way. And with Hoop Dreams, you know, I've had several people tell me, which I love when they say this, is that when they watched that film, they felt they went back and forth between thinking that the pursuit of basketball as this way out of poverty was a blessing, and then later in the film they think, oh no, this is a curse. And then later in the film they go, wait, maybe it is a blessing, and they would go back and forth on that. And to me, I just feel like it's a more honest, for me personally, it's a more honest way to look and examine that, because frankly, I feel the same way about it. I feel the same complex pool of feelings both ways. And so, you know, it's probably one of the reasons why I don't think of myself as an activist filmmaker, even though my films are very much about, you know, larger issues in some fashion. I felt like an activist filmmaker with an agenda. Even though I see films that I think are incredible and incredibly important in that way, I don't think of myself as that kind of filmmaker.
I see you as a liberal filmmaker. And, no, in your country you can't say liberal because it means something else. But
yeah,
it's the Rousseauian version of liberal, with its kind of good human values and the rights to freedom and speech and these kinds of things. So imbued in your work too. I mean, this is growing up in America as a, you know, well-educated, and I guess through film school as well, and you're exposing yourself to the world in film school and to most of the films you're choosing in your top 10, this part, your early career or in your film education really came
right
to you, and these are what have influenced you over the last 20 or so years, but you also have these kind of core values that were what passed on from your parents, or it seems from the Iverson film. Anyway, it was nice to get to know them and then know you through them.
Yeah,
I think just back to Rashomon film. I thought the Iverson film is your Rashomon, your Citizen Kane, mm-hmm. Well, not Citizen Kane, but the idea of Citizen Kane discovering what a personality is.
That's true. That's
you're sort
point.
Of yeah. taking, because there was an ambiguous crime for Iverson was accused of, and
right.
no evidence really, but then you really try to investigate with your camera what the reality is in that case.
Right, yeah, you're right. And yeah, because I didn't, there was at the heart of the Iverson bowling alley brawl, there was this central dispute about what he did and didn't do. He was charged and eventually convicted. But to this day, there are very strong feelings as to whether he was innocent or guilty. And they did tend to break down along the lines of race, although not exclusively. And so that film really is very much about race in my community. And it's interesting when you try to do a film about race in America, I think. And the Iverson film is the most explicit film of mine that's about race. It's, I mean, it's very much centrally the topic, whereas race is very much a part of what Hoop Dreams is about without it being overtly addressed in that way. It's very much what The Interrupters is about that's playing here, although not, again, not overtly. People aren't talking about race in that way. In the Iverson film, they very much are. And one of the things I've found over the years is that one of the things we don't like to do in America is talk about race, even though it's one of the defining things of our history, clearly. We don't like to talk about it. I find that African Americans don't mind talking about it so much. In fact, because it's such a central thing to their experience historically and otherwise, they're much more willing to talk about race. White people have a hard time talking about race because in America, because they feel like if they express themselves candidly, they could be called racist, unless all they say is that espouse liberal, you know, notions. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things I was really happy about in the Iverson film is that we actually got people to express themselves candidly, both white and black, about this issue. But there were many people that refused to even be interviewed about the Iverson case who were involved because they didn't want to talk about race. In fact, people who told me, and this was an incident that happened 17 years ago, I just got a new job. I don't want people to know that I was even in the bowling alley. And because then people at work, I might lose my job, or they might want to talk to me about it, and I don't want to talk about it. So,
by extension, one could analyze perhaps Stevie and the Grey Gardens as about class. I mean,
yes.
Those two women really were in kind of very upper class America, fallen angels into this Long Island decrepit mansion, and Stevie of a different class than yours. And that's another Absolutely. Word you really can't use in America either, because everybody thinks they're in the middle class, I guess.
Yeah.
Or the 99% people do.
No, and I think that a lot of times in America, race replaces class as the dividing line. And in our discussions, and in our debates, and in fact, class is also a very big part of it, but not really talked about. No, when I was working on Stevie and before people had seen any of it, when I would tell people what it was about, I was doing a film about a kid I was once a big brother to, and he's gotten into a lot of trouble and blah, 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 and I'd kind of tell them basically what it is. I had so many people tell me when the film came out and they saw it, they said, oh, I had no idea he was white. Mm-hmm. And I never said he was black or white, but the assumption was, based on my description, was that he had to be black. Mm-hmm. And so the fact that he was white was a shock to them.
Let's move then to our fourth pair of films.
The Times of Harvey Milk. I'm going to do my survey. How many people have seen Times of Harvey Milk? Okay. You really owe yourself, if you haven't, to see this film. You really should see all these films, I think. I know you
don't
probably...
watch any other film.
I know you want to see some newer films. Okay, fine. But, you know. But this... Times of Harvey Milk was a film I saw when I was in grad school studying film, and I went there wanting to make movies, fiction, by the time I left there, I was much more interested in making documentaries, and this was certainly one of those films that made me really want to make documentaries. It's a film, how many people have seen the film Milk? You know the story? More people. So. Yeah, it's that story of Harvey Milk, the San Francisco activist who was murdered, and it was it's a great documentary about a movement really in San Francisco and coming to power of gay power in San Francisco, and of course the tragic dimensions of that, which is that Harvey Milk paid with his life for his activism and growing power. And so when I saw this film, I just, it's a film that's not really a verite film, which is more in the tradition I've evolved to being in. Rob Epstein, who directed it, started out to make a film that he thought would be a verite film, but then when Milk was murdered, he changed his concept. And this is something that I have experienced and many filmmakers have, which is you start out with one idea that you think, this is the way I'm going to make this film. And you think you've got it all figured out about how you're going to go about making this film, and then events change it. And it happened in Stevie. It was literally going to be a half-hour portrait of this kid that I was once a big brother to, and then once he committed this crime, it completely changed what that film would be. And the same thing happened to Rob Epstein with the film Times of Harvey Milk. And so some of that great verite footage that he was collecting is very much part of the film. But the heart and soul of the film, really, in my view, is these incredible interviews he did with a very select group of people who were really able to bring all of this to life, and incredible archival footage as well. And so so the sequence I'm going to show is just late in the film. It's when, you know, the community turns out in support of Harvey Milk and the mayor, who was murdered too, along, you know, at the same time, who was also very sympathetic, very liberal mayor and sympathetic to gay rights. So it's a candlelight march. And if you've seen the film Milk, to me it's the most moving part of the fictional version of this. And it's really, it's Rob Epstein's footage, I think, that's in Milk, that's the most moving part of that movie for me. And even though I like the film Milk, to me it can't really, just pardon the pun, because it's a candlelight march, it can't hold a candle to Rob's film. But, so we're going to show that sequence, and then I'm going to show a scene from this film I did called with Peter Gilbert for Kartemkin, and all these films I did with Kartemkin except Real Paradise, at the Death House Door, which is about a pastor who was a death house chaplain. His job was to be with these guys on the last day of their life. So he did this 95 times. He would meet them in the morning, and he would be with them throughout the day. Talk to them, comfort them, take their confessions if they wanted to confess, help them get the meal they wanted, just be there for them, and then see them through to their death, being put to death by lethal injection after midnight that night. And so the sequence I'm going to show from that is, part of that film is about Pickett's coming from being pro-death penalty when he took the job to being against the death penalty, and a big part of what caused him to change his views was this one inmate named Carlos de Luna, who of the 95 men that he was with was the most haunting to him because he felt he was innocent when he was with him. And part of what the film's about is that there's this investigation many years later that the film tracks that makes a very strong case that, in fact, Carlos de Luna was innocent. So the other, a lot of setup for this, but the other detail you need to know is that one of the distinctive characteristics of Carol Pickett was that he would come home at night after each of these executions, so he had 95 of these tapes, and he would get out a little cassette recorder and record what happened that day. It was his way of dealing and coping with it. So in this sequence, you'll hear his voice on the tape recorder in a few places, and he's in his office listening in the present to himself from the past. So it may be a little hard to follow, but just as a side note, Carol Pickett is interviewed in the new Werner Herzog film, Into the Abyss. So, because that's about another guy that he was with the last day of his life. So here's a sequence from both Times of Harvey Milk and from The Death House Door.
Thousands and thousands of people, and that feeling of such loss, having lost someone who was so important and something, you know, Harvey stood for something more than just him.
Combination of Harvey and killed, and a combination of going down with all those people. I don't know if you call it expressing your grief or what it was, but being with all those people, and it's nighttime in San Francisco, and a bunch of strangers around you, and you feel as safe as if you're doing your own home.
Simply stated, Carlos DeLuna, he was dead at 12:24.
After Carlos was pronounced dead, the tie-down team had taken all the straps off and they left. I chose not to leave. So I went over and took him by the right hand and just held him. Just held his right hand with both hands. And I thought, well, maybe I can make it up to him by holding on to his hand as long as possible. And I held on to it until finally I decided it was over. And I asked the funeral director just to come on in.
The systems broke, but no man should die alone without a friend. I think that's what I was.
Yeah, I was talking to a critic last night from, I think, the New York Times or Variety about this film that we were going to be doing this today, because I'd seen the Herzog the other night on the big screen. Saw it on a DVD during the summer, but it's so apparent now that that's just a. I don't know why Herzog made the film on this one. It's been made, really, no, it's a bit, it angers me a bit. But this is just has a kind of power and emotion and directness to it. And also the example, we're moving into kind of an emotional space here, which is, I think, probably the hardest thing to do maybe in cinema. Maybe it's easier in fiction to kind of create emotion in documentary. And you do it so well with that scene. I still remember that scene. We played that film too here. In the Iverson and Tyson case, we were trying to, both you and Koppel trying to construct a personality without access to the main characters, really, and with archive and everything else, and recreation of by interviews of others around. But it's an issue, say, the death penalty, that's important, I guess, to you, but. You bring it to the documentary to an emotional space, which really is an effective kind of educational tool.
Well, yeah, thank you, Peter. I think when I wanted to do this film, it wasn't because I was felt strongly about the death penalty. I mean, I knew that I was against the death penalty, and I never really thought much about it, to be honest. What made me want to do this film was this guy, Carol Pickett. I just wanting to understand how a guy could be with 95 guys being put to death, do that job. And when I heard about the cassette tapes, which at the time were a secret, we found out about it through a reporter who he had revealed one of the tapes to and told them that he had others. He had never told anybody about these tapes. That he only got a little brief bit of it at the beginning, so I'm sorry. I thought I'd given you more of that. But he never even told his family about these tapes. Like, his wife knew, of course, but his adult children didn't know that he was recording these tapes. So when I heard about these tapes, I just thought, that I want to know what that guy went through. And the fact that he went from being pro-death penalty for some very compelling reasons to being against the death penalty by this experience makes it all the more interesting. But even if he had not changed his view, I would have wanted to do this film. That, you know, because just to understand how you do that and what that does to you is interesting enough to me. And so I think when you're, the great thing about, I think, having full access to your central subject is that, you know, in we spent about 2.5 years making this film, and we filmed for about a year and a half altogether. And we interviewed Carol Pickett many, many, many times, in a sense. We listened to tapes with him that he had not heard since he recorded them years earlier, and that prompted discussion. And it was this incredibly intensive experience of talking to him over the course of a year and a half. And it was intensely therapeutic for him. And yet, you know, and as a filmmaker, it's sort of like, I tell this to young filmmakers, it's sort of like, if you interview someone once, you get one kind of truth. If you interview them twice, you get a different kind of truth. If you keep coming back, if they let you keep coming back, you will eventually get to a place where you really get, I think, fairly deeply into what this person, what their life is and what they've experienced. They just, and it's not that they were being calculatedly guarded or dishonest with you. It's in some, I mean, it's a trust thing, but it's also just the more you plumb their memories by talking to them, the more they remember, the more they get in touch with those feelings and what they were really thinking and feeling at the time.
Is there a kind of reverse therapy too? We call codependency in psychological terms. I mean, the more you're there, the more he's teaching you away about trying to understand why it is you don't care whether or not you're making a film about the death penalty, and maybe that changes you in some certain way as well, about depth within the Steve.
Absolutely.
Within the Saint Steve.
Absolutely. Yeah, Saint Steve, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, I found by doing this film that even though my politics about the death penalty didn't change, I came to have a much, much deeper and fuller understanding of why this is such an important issue. But I didn't start with that. I didn't start with saying, oh, this is an important issue that needs to be out there.
Right.
Because there's been a lot of films made about the death penalty, a lot of really great films made about the death penalty.
But not so great ones, Mr. Herzog.
Ooh, ouch.
I'm speaking as a critic and not as a host.
Okay. Any of you bloggers out there? No.
Twitterocracy.
Yeah. But I do think that absolutely, and I've had my eyes open so many times over the years through the course of making films about politically, morally, ethically, in every respect. I mean, it's the reason to make these films, right? Sometimes I hear filmmakers say, "I knew exactly what I wanted to get, and I got it," and maybe that works, clearly it works for some filmmakers. I can't imagine that though. I can imagine thinking you know exactly what you want to get, but I can't ever imagine just getting that. Because maybe I just have a lesser imagination, but I always feel like what I get is way more interesting than whatever it is I thought I was looking mm-hmm. for.
Are you working from a kind of proposal and script in the kind of general...
Not a script, but, you know, in order to raise money, as you know, just as well as I do, in order to raise money, you have to write up something. And depending on what the film is that, you know, it's, to get funders, sometimes the proposal you write up, the treatment, is certainly pretty detailed, and sometimes it certainly encompasses the major themes of whatever your film is going to be. That's not that unusual. But I think it's in the particulars that films are interesting, right? And so, you know, and so they end up hopefully being far richer, far more nuanced, far more complicated than what you wrote up. And sometimes you don't know who your characters are going to be. Like when we did this series, The New Americans, which involved a number of filmmakers, and they played it here at IDFA. Thank you, IDFA. Some years ago, it was a mini-series, seven-hour mini-series, where we followed five different immigrant stories from their home countries to America over a period of years. The original proposals for that just gave, for instance, kinds of characters, like we might follow a Russian cab driver, or, you know, I just said, for instance, because we didn't know who our characters were going to be at that point. We actually needed funding to go find who our characters were going to be. So it was more of a thematic idea than a particular idea. Mm-hmm. Whereas a film like Stevie, I could write about in much more detail because I had a history with him, but then I couldn't get any funding for that film. So
the more you know, the less you get.
Yeah.
I think that's probably
that's the way it works. Yeah. We are going to get to questions. I think we just have one more.
Yeah, one more pair, and then we will get to questions.
This one, Le Joli Mai, the Chris Marker film, is a film that I saw again in grad school, and to me it was a film that just opened my eyes about, I mean, what a great filmmaker he is, but also just, you know, it's a film that's so eclectic and so freewheeling. It's almost like it's got five different styles in it. And it really impressed upon me that there's no rules about any of this, and that there's no rules within any even one film. You can say, well, I'm making a certain kind of film, but Chris Marker would say, well, I'm making a certain kind of scene here, and then when I get over here, something else is called for. And so this is a film where you see him on the margins of the frame having these great conversations with people. This is a film that has very poetic passages. This is a film that has imagery that Cartier-Bresson would be proud to have taken. I mean, this is a film that has a stream of consciousness structure where one interview with somebody on the street prompts him to go find something else, and so he just follows. I've always wanted, my fantasy, and I haven't given up on this fantasy, my fantasy is to do a film like this about Chicago, because this is a film that's really a portrait of France, in particular Paris, at a particularly interesting time. It's kind of what it is in its broadest sense, but it's way more than that, of course. And I've always thought it would be great to do something like this in Chicago.
Well, we might work on that, on this Chinese idea we have.
Yes, that's right.
And there's also information in this. I remember this Arc de Triomphe scene where just data and information.
That's right.
Statistics about France.
Exactly. He does a time-lapse thing where he just gives you so many people were married today, so many people went to jail today, so many people were released, so many babies were born. So it's just this incredible film. Anyway, he's such a poetic filmmaker. I am not a poetic filmmaker, but I'm going to show you a passage that I felt, I hope, in some ways, has a little bit of poetry to it, from the most current film, The Interrupters. And the sequence from Le Joli Mai is also a poetic passage that's narrated, written by Chris Marker, but narrated by the great actress Simone
Signoret.
The sequence I'm going to show from The Interrupters is just a sequence where this is a film about, if you haven't seen it, it's a film about this group in Chicago that tries to mediate violent conflicts in urban neighborhoods in Chicago. And Chicago is a city beset by urban violence. And so one of the things that is very common in the States, in big cities, is that when someone is killed in these neighborhoods, people will construct an impromptu shrine to them where people will come and write comments or put flowers or teddy bears or liquor bottles or whatever. And so this is a sequence in the film, a passage in the film, where we kind of go around the city and see some different shrines that have been mounted to honor the fallen. So first, Chris Marker, and then The Interrupters.
When prisoners think of the city, it is of these two wonders, doors which open from the inside and steps which go in a straight line. During this month, we have crossed Paris in a straight line. Just as our journey could be made up of all those miles that prisoners cover in a circle from wall to wall, we tried to look through the eyes of a prisoner on his first day of freedom, when he, himself, tries to understand how these strange phenomenons, free people, live. We've met free people. We have given them the biggest roles in this film. Those who are able to question, to refuse, to undertake, to think, or simply to love. They were not without contradictions or mistakes, but they persevered even with their mistakes, and perhaps truth is not only the end, perhaps it's also the means. But we have met others, in great number, who would amaze the prisoner, for their prison is inside themselves.
Brother on the left side, and my little cousin on the right side, Tyrone Williams and Percy Davis Jr.
Trying to sign Michael's altar. I held him to his last breath. I didn't want to let him go.
I've lost at least 20 guys. There's no answer to it. You know, you're one of your guys that killed, fuck it, I'm gonna kill that nigga and make his family suffer. I don't want no shrine, beer bottles, drinks, niggas crying, smoking weed, pictures and shit, t-shirts. I don't want none of that shit. I don't wanna die looking stupid as hell. Oh, fuck that.
You, well, you are a poet, you know, a social poet. You know, I was really happy when I heard you were making that film. It's just kind of the great examples of people. So they're based on the kind of holy angels of intervention. I'm a kind of pacifist myself, just to figure out how you can reconcile differences in the kind of gangs of Chicago, but also. They do eventually, a few of them, transcend their roots and find jobs. There's kind of hope in that film. It's another one of your great longitudinal projects. It's also horizontal. It's,
yeah, that's right.
It's in terms of length you have to spend in the cinema, but I was chiding you maybe in Australia about that, but it's really worth every minute. If you can see the interrupters here, there is a kind of poetry there. And I really thank you as well for bringing Chris Marker. He is a master. And that film I saw, I think in East Germany with Russian subtitles, with translated by a live German. So I didn't understand the film until you made us see it again here. But his work is adventurous and poetic, so, and eclectic.
Yeah.
So thanks for bringing those. I don't know if we do. You want to continue about the interrupters and that? Maybe we just take
come see it. I think it's, is it playing tonight?
It should have all the schedules.
Yep. Yeah, it's playing. I think it's tonight. We'll
it's had some really a great success too. You've been really hard to get a hold of the last year. You've been traveling a lot with that film, and I'm glad it's enjoyed the worldwide audience as well.
Yeah, it's been great.
Well, as many of your films have. I mean, Hoop Dreams is a giant hit. Really,
yeah.
It was one of the great hits of documentary lore. Maybe as you say, Stevie less so. But you do have great supporters, I know, with your international sales agents and television broadcasters and BBC.
I've been very fortunate.
And bringing films here. So maybe there's an opportunity for questions from you if you've enjoyed other films of Steve's over the years. Or,
well, you don't have to talk about that.
Or even if you don't enjoy them.
You can say you don't like them, too. That's fine.
Can I say that? No. I would be dishonest. Our thoughts. Yes, please. We have a microphone because we're recording all of this for the web stream and everything else. So, if you could wait for a second or hold up your hand, we'll get the first question, and then you think others can think of other questions while we're taking this one.
I'm not familiar with all your work, so this question is based partly on ignorance. Just wondering. You mentioned Mads Brügger, the Danish documentary maker, earlier on with his movie The Ambassador, and he's also made a movie about a visit to North Korea. And Michael Moore was also mentioned. Do you ever, can you ever see yourself getting involved in your own movies as Mads Brügger and Michael Moore get involved?
Well, yeah, I mean, I didn't show you. I've actually been in two of my films. Stevie, I'm very much a part of that. I didn't show you a scene that I'm in. But it's very different, and I'm also in the Allen Iverson film because I go back to my hometown, I interview my mom and other people. So I've been in two of my films. When I started out to make films, I never in a million years thought I would ever be in a film of mine. I mean, it was beyond my thinking. And it happened first in Stevie, because that was a film made before. And in that case, the reason I ended up being in that film, I felt, was once he was arrested and charged with this crime, the central question for me at that moment, as it related to the film, was do I continue to make the film or not? Because I could have just stopped making the film and maybe just acted in some informal way as a big brother again to try to help that situation. And by help, I don't mean try to help him get off, but help him deal with it in a way that, you know, was going to be ultimately the right thing and in his best interest. I felt compelled to play that role, but I also wanted to continue to make the film. And so I felt like if I was going to make the film and do that, that I needed to become part of it, that I needed to be honest in that. And so the film shows me in some very bumbling ways trying to get him to get therapy. And, you know, as Gordon Quinn from Kartemquin, who's worked with me on a lot of these films, either he shot part of the film and as a producer or an executive producer, said that Steve James in the film is naive. The film itself isn't naive. and so, but I'm in that film, but I'm not in that film in the way Michael Moore's in his films at all. It's very different.
Because it seems to me that even in The Ambassador, which I haven't seen yet, but I've read a lot about it and I've seen some clips, that he is the story. Uh-huh. So I guess that's my question. Could you ever imagine being the story?
No.
Okay.
No, no.
Any reason, any particular reason for that? Is that your...
I'm not that interested in my story. The Iverson film is more autobiographical than Stevie, clearly. I'm much more revealed in Stevie. It's a much more candid, revealing film, because I also ask questions about whether I should be making the film or not in that film. And some people who've seen the film say, you shouldn't have, you know. You shouldn't have made it. But in the Iverson film, it's more autobiographical because I'm talking about my hometown and my past as it relates to understanding of race and all this. But there, it's very circumscribed. I didn't want to make the film about me. I just felt that what few places I had something to offer that illuminated what my hometown, that was the value of it. But beyond that, I didn't want to make it a film about me.
You don't want to make it a film about me, but it's all about me, really. Because every film I've seen of yours really is about you. Your obsessions, in a way. You know that if Hoop Dreams took 7 years to complete, that when you start to engage in a long-term project, most of them have been, probably except for Real Paradise, that you're pouring yourself into these films in a way, but not necessarily to appear in them. But
no.
You're not a belligerent buffoon stand-up comic like my friend Michael Moore, but he's a friend. What else is it? He's got 7 joke writers working in his crew. I know, but or the great Mats, who is a performance artist, really.
Right.
So. But you are as much in your films as they are in a way.
Okay. You say so. I know what you're saying.
No, I mean, even if our Finnish commissioning editor, Ika Vihalati, will say an issue is not a film, a problem is not a film. These are givens, but you are in those films. You're shooting some of them, too, sometimes.
Yeah,
you pick up a camera sometimes.
Yeah, I shot The Interrupters and on New Americans too.
So it's your eye there.
But I try not to shoot too often. It's too hard to work. I'd rather somebody else do that.
Yeah. Some other ideas or questions or comments? Yes, please. Just beside you there, and then behind you there too as well. Okay.
Thanks. One of the things, actually, The Interrupters is playing tomorrow night, not tonight.
Oh, thank you.
Okay.
What time?
It's at the Tuchinsky at 18, so that's what?
Six.
In your time, 6 o'clock. Okay.
Good time. I think you all can make that, right?
So I think one of the things that's kind of is underrated about your filmmaking is what always surprises me when I see your films is you're basically this white guy from a certain class, and yet you're able to go into these communities and get access in a way that maybe a lot of people from their own community would only be able to get. And I'm just wondering if you can talk a little bit about gaining the trust of these people. And I mean, that's a talent in itself. I think I was thinking Hedy Honigman is another person who is really able to gain trust in a way that a lot of filmmakers aren't able to do. And I think more people should give you kudos for that. So if you can talk a little bit about that, that would be interesting.
Well, thank you. I think a key is openness. I feel like whenever I go into any film, wherever it is, wherever it takes place, I try to take this attitude of I'm here to understand and I'm here to learn. I'm not here to judge. I think and I'm curious, you know, and I think, and people are curious about, you know, I just think it's all about the relationship. If you can establish some kind of connection to to people, and you don't go in pretending to know more than you do, because you're not trying to impress them. I don't go in trying to impress people with what I already know. I go in trying to, if I'm trying to impress them, it's with what I don't know. it's what, you know, that I'm here to understand and learn. And I think, you know, I think, and depending on the film, it takes time to build that trust. Sometimes it happens more quickly than others, but I also am not, you know, there's sort of two strands of cinema verite filmmaking broadly, and I'm going to oversimplify it. There's the more fly-on-the-wall approach where you don't interact with the subjects much at all, either in the film in terms of interviewing them, but also in your personal relationships with them, that you show up and you kind of document what happens, and you do your best to be that piece of furniture in the room. I am not of that school. There are tremendous results gotten in that approach, but I am not. I'm of the approach of you go in and try to actually have a relationship with the subject and get them to a place of comfort with you so that they can be themselves and not and feel comfortable around you because they trust you. And I think the trust thing is a big part of it. I think the easiest thing to do, and it's the biggest, to me, it's the single biggest danger of making documentaries, is to make a film in which you're encouraging the audience to sit in judgment. Sometimes you should judge, you know, and if you're make a polemical filmmaker and that's what you want, then I guess that's what you're after. I'm not a polemical filmmaker, so I'm always trying to resist that. I feel like the films have a point of view and I want you to be outraged at certain things, but I'm really uncomfortable with sitting in easy judgment, because it is the easiest thing to do in a movie theater. I think you're in the dark, you're safe, they're up there on the screen, and it's so easy to sit there and just kind of go, this guy, you know? And I think when it's fiction film, there's not that high of stakes. When it's a documentary, it's much higher. So I'm rambling, but I feel like a key to that too is spending the time. And so the films in which you can spend time there, you will ultimately, I think, come to understand things in a different way than you would if you just go there and spend a little bit of time.
There was a question at the back there, in the back on the right. Yeah, just raise your hand there and the mic will get there in a second.
Yeah, hi. I just want to ask a question that I think it, maybe it's very basic, so I apologize. But
that's okay.
I just wanted to ask you what was your main reason, you know, when you were graduating? What is the difference going into or your desire to go into documentaries as opposed to going to fiction films?
No, that's a good question. You know, I had studied a little. As an undergraduate, I had been in radio journalism and had been thinking I might, you know, work for National Public Radio or something. That was an interest. Until I fell in love with film. I think what it was is that I think it some of those impulses got combined with the documentaries. In pursuing documentaries, I think part of it is that I just, you know, I'm fascinated by people and real people, and when I got exposed to some documentaries, both watching them in graduate school as well as getting an opportunity to make some little short films, I just fell in love with the idea of being able to go out and have a reason to go out and just satisfy my curiosity about people and who they were. Like, one of the first films I made was a 3-minute Super 8 movie in grad school. Was I went out and did a film about people and their cars, like what's in their cars. So like I interviewed, I found like an old guy that had this old, beautiful old car that he maintained in pristine shape, and I talked to him about his car and what was in it, which was virtually nothing. Then I found this other guy who the back of his car was like he was living in it. He wasn't, but it looked that way. And so I talked to him about his car, and I don't know. I just love talking to them. My wife and I lived in an apartment complex where the landlady was a woman who wore a black eye patch and sang religious songs and played them on her organ. And I was like, who is this woman? And so I made a little film about her. And so I think it was just one of these things where I fell in love with this idea. And to me, it's the best thing about making documentaries, which is you get this reason and this passport to go explore in ways that we don't normally permit ourselves to do, right? We don't have a reason to do it. But when I fell into documentary, I fell into wanting to tell stories because of that impulse to want to tell stories in that fictional realm, to tell a good story. And so most of my films, the best parts of my films, I feel like, are the parts where they are scenes that maybe could almost be like out of a fiction film, except they just happen to be true. Those are the scenes I live for. Those are the moments I live for as a documentary filmmaker that I feel most privileged to be witness to.
And you capture a lot of them because you're there for so long with the people, too. it's a reason why they're so strong, too. The stories are there, the arcs of stories, or whatever it's called these days. But other questions? Yes, please, at the back. Another. You could pass the mic over there. Thank you.
I was wondering, you mentioned the word exploitative when you were discussing the Grey Gardens segment together with your Stevie segment. And in the last 2 days at the festival, it seems to me that I've already seen lots of films in which you'd almost consider a kind of a change of turns or turn of events where the characters seem to be exploiting the documentary filmmaker or seem to be using the documentary film as a vehicle to achieve something else. Right. I mean, I can give a couple of examples. One is a Gretchen road movie about a Brazilian artist who seems to actually run for mayor in order to get a film made about her political budding career. Uh-huh. Another one would be a Danish film called The Will, where the main character actually contacted the filmmaker and said, please, I'm going to inherit a lot of money. Right. I'm a pretty fucked up person. I have a great story in my family to tell. It's all very dark. Make a film about me.
Right.
And he was there yesterday, and it was very moving, actually, to see him at the Q&A, because the film is very dark about him, and it's not very flattering. But he explained that it was part of his dealing with his own life, having this film made, and he was extremely happy to be here. And it seemed all like a wonderful opportunity, but at the same time, you're really wondering, are these characters, are these subjects not exploiting the filmmaker? And can you comment on that?
Yeah, no, I think that's a great question. I haven't seen those films, but occasionally I get emails or correspondences from people who say, I have a great story, would you be interested in doing my story? And it's funny, I never really pursue those. Real Paradise was John Pearson's idea, one of the central subjects. It was his idea to do this film, and he asked me to do the film. And in that case, that was a situation where I did. When I think about why, I think it was partly because of a friendship with him, but also I was just fascinated with the whole idea, knowing John and knowing his personality, of what must it be like in Fiji with him there showing movies. And so I took it on. But I think this is a different question than you're asking, but it does become tricky in those situations, I think, when your central subject has played a role in the creation of the film, because it makes it incumbent upon you to really make as honest a film as you can make, even though it's a different dynamic that has led to the creation of this film. And it can get really tricky with that. In general, I tend to want to make films about people that don't think anyone should make films about them. Those are the people I tend to be attracted to, or the people that you, when you say, well, I'd like to do a film on you, they're like, really? What, why would you want to make a film on me? You know, it's, and as a corollary to that, I found that over the years, the most interesting people to interview are the people that don't think they should be interviewed. It's the people that I've found that go, oh, great, yeah, you'll come in, we'll do this interview, and I can't wait to talk to you and all that. And then you go and interview them, and they're never quite as interesting as they were when you were talking to them on the phone. And a lot of times they get very nervous, actually, because they have performance anxiety. And it's the people that don't think of themselves as worthy of an interview that open up, because they're not used to having people ask them about things. They're not used to people being curious about them. And I find that, you know, I think one of the things that separates documentary, one of the many things that separates documentary from reality television is that in a lot of reality television, it's all about people who merely want to be famous. That's their reason to do it, is they want to be famous. Whereas documentaries tend to mostly be about people for whom that's not the motivation. It may become a byproduct of it. And when it does in an organic way, I think it's a wonderful thing. But that's not their motivation for being in it.
I see kind of a evolution in kind of the relationship of subject matter or character, if we call them the people we're on the other side of our lens.
Right. There's no good name for that.
No, there's never a good name in the documentary world any for that. But there has been an evolution, I think, over the last 20 years. Of kind of liberation of their role, and as they start to challenge the role of what used to be a kind of vampirism, I call it. We're sucking stories out of people. We have the power as filmmakers, and we're just exploiting people. And there's been a kind of democratization of that role, where now when we're making films about people, it's changed to we're making films with people.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody ever gets the right to see or final cut, I guess not final cut in your case, but we're starting to share those kinds of things with our subjects. And now maybe this is the nth evolution of this tendency where we have the demands of characters to participate more fully.
Yeah, at Kartemquin, we've always had this philosophy that the main subjects of your film should get to see it before it's done. And it's a promise I make to people very early in the process. And again, to me, that's part of the trust building. And I don't say you're going to have editorial control. I'm very explicit about that. But I say you're going to see this before it's done, and we're going to talk about it. And there may be things in there that you think are wrong, that we just plain got wrong, or that feel, too revealing in a way. And certainly, let's talk about it. And so I've done that on every film, and sometimes that process is very simple. People watch it, they kind of, they're happy with it, they're fine with it. They may have a few little points they make. Usually it makes the film better, frankly. They'll say, you know, in that situation. So whenever I do these things, I always am prepared to film too, because I've often gotten really great additional things, be it voiceover or something else, from this process. And sometimes it's a painful process, you know. Sometimes it's a hard process. I wouldn't characterize it as painful on Real Paradise, but I would characterize it as the most thorough, because I was filming people who are film people. And John and Janet are sophisticated film people, and so they're looking at this film not just a film about themselves, but they're looking at a film as people who are very sophisticated about filmmaking. And so that process was a much different process than showing it to the interrupter subjects in the current film. And so, but I do think that's part of the trust. I think if you build a level of trust with your subjects, it can seem almost paradoxical in a way that the more control you give them, in a sense, or feeling of making a film with them, not about them, and that they have some control, the more revealing they will be. The more they will actually give you by feeling safe enough to do that.
In our last couple of minutes, I want to return to your genesis, we'll say, when you were making 3-minute films about people with patches on their eyes, to your most recent film, an opus of not 3 hours as your average running time, but 3 minutes in a project called Cineland, which tonight upstairs will be announcing a kind of project inviting 30 of the world's great filmmakers, you among them, to make 3-minute films sort of about progress and future. And you did a kind of pilot for them recently, last year, I guess, that we could play a clip of what's it called?
Yeah, it's called Paradise Regained.
Oh, yes.
But don't play it quite yet. But this is, Cinelon started a few years ago, and they approached me and a number of filmmakers about making 3-minute films on whatever you want to make it on. Initially, and they've gotten sponsorship for different things since then, which have been great. For instance, leading up to the last general election that Obama was elected, Channel 4 commissioned them to do a few films on, to hear from unheard voices in America on the election, and I got to executive produce that series. I did one of the films, and we had three other filmmakers make them, and it was a really fun project to do, and we made 4 separate little 3-minute films, and they aired on Channel 4 leading up to the election last year. This one was the first one I did when Cinelon contacted me, and it actually was inspired by an idea from my partner on The Interrupters, Alex Kotlowitz, the writer. He had written about this interesting outsider artist in Chicago, and I loved his piece on it. It appeared in a book he did, and so I went and did a 3-minute film on it. And when you watch this film, you're going to see the whole film, which is great. But when you watch, well, I hope it's great anyway. But when you watch it, think about the fact that, I mean, I think you could make a much bigger piece on this guy. There's a lot more to his story than you get from this 3 minutes, but I hope as a 3-minute film it satisfies. And I also wanted to be able to prove to myself that I could actually make a 3-minute film. It's 3 minutes and 8 seconds, so I got pretty close. But this is called Paradise Regained.
Most people know me as the artist. They never knew my name.
For about 15 years, I painted murals on people's walls of Robert Taylor homes. The projects were about 2 miles long.
You know, it kind of helped me when they tore the projects down. The customers, they all called me back to do the same work again that I did in the apartment before.
This lady had me, believe it or not, I painted every room in her house. Even the hallways, the washroom.
Now, so many people got different ideas about this picture, okay? Whichever way you want it to be, that's the way it is in your head. They just having a nice time. This is the paradise. My mother and father both passed away. And this is the place I would love them to be.
People did love landscapes just make them feel like they're in a place where they're not at the Robert Taylor's. They wanted blue skies and then clouds. But tying the projects down is something they should have did a long time ago, because we were steady killing each other. I had some people say, just put me a graveyard on the wall, like this. I can remember doing 8 on one side and about 7 on the other side, tombstone, will make me sorry, sad sometimes. All them people that they knew, they tried to come up with new ideas. It was this lady in a project. She told me, just imagine that there's a hole in my wall, what you will see behind there. I drew the bricks in like it was broke out, okay? Like the bricks were broke off, like a bomb just came through and blew this out. And on the wall right here, you can see the nice Sears Tower. Behind all that is clouds in the sky and everything. I loved it. She had paid me $70, came to me with food, alcohol. She slipped back on the couch, relaxing and listening to her music. And when I finished it, she gave me $70 more. And then she said, I want you to come back tomorrow. The next day, she said, now I want you to draw right here. I want you to draw me doing like this, with my hand like this. Standing right here like that with my hand like that. I said, oh, she wanted me to make it look like she pushed a hole in the wall or something like that. She said, come back the next day and I'll pay you more money. I want you to draw a man that keep falling out like that. She want a picture of her pushing her husband out the window. God, she must have hate that man of hers. She ready to make him out an ex-husband. Once I had work shown in a little show that let me know that my work was really good, somebody stole my paint. I said, oh, my work must be really valuable.
The tide keeps a lifting. The tide keeps a lifting me.
Hey, I guess I did my comedy.
Very good. Now, we just have a couple of minutes, and it's a perfect time that Gordon Quinn, the Quinn of Cartem Quinn, is walking in the door. You've worked on almost every film together with Cartem. We just have Gordon. He's just been doing the Q&A of his own film, and you also chose...
I also chose
Gollum. Another film about an artist.
Another film about an artist, that's right.
Yeah, so we have just a couple of minutes, really... a microphone. Maybe you figure out how. Just tell us how you met each other. You went knocking on his door, I think.
Do you want to tell that story?
Well, from my point of view, this is quite a while ago. A couple of tall guys walked into Cartemquin, and they had an idea to do a film about some young people who played street basketball, and a great name, Hoop Dreams. And they had $2,500 that they had gotten from a grant that they'd written to the Illinois Arts Council, public funding for the arts. So I knew they kind of had their act together. And soon after that, I said, well, you know, it's an African-American subject. You should maybe find an African-American cameraman. And they went out looking for that and came back with Peter Gilbert, who was already associated with Cartemquin, who was also obsessed with basketball.
And white.
And white, yeah. And but I knew they were the right team, and we've been involved in all kinds of projects ever since. Many that have been here at IDFA, including the New Americans, which was our biggest project together.
And you just had a film that you screened just now, right?
A good Man is here, a film about Bill T. Jones, the dancer. Every 15 years or so, I do something about an artist. Most of our films are about social issues.
Yes.
But it makes you reflect on yourself. And Steve actually picked for his 10 best a film we did about an artist many years ago, Gollum, that's also in the festival.
Yeah. You really owe it to yourself to see this film. It's a film that they were finishing when I first got involved at Cartemquin. And I knew about their past work doing labor films and, films more in that vein. But they were doing this profile of this really interesting, politically-minded artist, Leon Gollub, and they just made a terrific biography of an artist because you get to know this guy, you get to really see his process up close, which is really fascinating, and along the way you come to understand the things and his politics and his view of the world and his art, and it's a really great film. And so it's there in the program to sort of represent Cartemquin as an institution, which has been around for 45 years, making great films all these years. And but when I was at IDFA a few years ago, one year, they made a mistake in the catalog. And they credited me as director of like virtually every film made at Cartemquin. So I had this biography that literally was like 40 films long, and it was like I was the most prolific filmmaker in the history of IDFA for that one year.
Well, Cartemquin really is a kind of model company, I think, especially in these survival times, I call them, that you work in a kind of, as a kind of director's label and a kind of, in my mind anyway, cooperatively and sharing roles on each other's films. And it's really, people with companies starting now could really think about the kind of model I think that Cartemquin was a leader in and still is.
Yeah, I mean, we've been celebrating our 45th year this year, and one of the things that we're in our, what I call our third phase, but we're a center where people come who have a passion to make a film about something. And that's what we see as our mission, to kind of be a place for documentaries that, you know, we're not a production house, we're not assigning projects to people. People come to us, and this is the thing they have to do. And, you know, we have, in the early days, we were a little company. Now we're a not-for-profit with a board, and I've actually stepped down as the executive director, and a young woman, Justine Nagin, has taken over. We hope to go on for another 45.
Well, you've influenced me, in fact, with my group, I Steal Film in Montreal, and we've got a couple of films in the first appearances, and with Last Train Home, which won a prize here a couple of years ago. But we also work in a kind of, try to model ourselves after Kartemkin. I think we're really, to the end, I would just really like to thank Steve and I mean, you invest so much, I think, time into these longitudinal, into your characters, and you take us on this kind of, I call it, kind of gentle gliding through the human condition in a way, in this gray St. Stephen way. gray is many, there are many shades of gray, and they're all beautiful. And you have this kind of quality of niceness, an aura. And nice is a nice word, I find. It's somehow a pejorative generally, but it's kind of quality one should really try to affirm and model oneself after. And I was just thinking this morning, writing notes for this, in the future, the filmmakers are going to be choosing the top 10. I mean, they could choose any one of your films, really, to be included in their top 10. So I would just like you to thank, please, Stephen James and Gordon Quinn.
Well, thank you, Peter. And it's such an honor to be here and to in this capacity this year at the festival. I love this festival, and this man is the most generous man in documentary right here, sitting to my right.
That's because I'm poor.